Thanks for carrying all this stuff.
Lois, there was something I wanted to tell you.
If it's about the trial coverage, it can wait till tomorrow. I've got to fly.
Lois, I have something to tell you.
Are our gifts, and I'm not much concerned with how people look at me. I really just want to help the other girls that are on the street that don't have a voice right now. These are good kids that have been sexually abused by relatives or friends of the family, kids that have went through a good deal of emotional abuse from parents that are drug users. They want love and they don't receive it from their home, and so they run away because they have no other choice. Someone has to be the advocate for teen prostitutes and teen runaways. It's not really about me. It's about someone being the advocate for the voice that remains unheard. It's about someone being the advocate for the children of the night. And that's what I want to be.
What does survival really mean when you're out there?
Keeping your sanity. You know, and at 14, what do you really know about survival? What you know is that you don't want to be in a dumpster. What you know is that you don't want to be cut. What you know is that you don't want to be beat up, you know. But the reality is that when you go out there and that's the life you live, you know, you're going to get cut.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You're going to get beat up. You're going to get robbed. You're going to get raped.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to get tortured verbally, mentally, physically, and emotionally by these people, you know, and that's what's not glorified in society.
Today on Trisha, these teens will get a startling look at their potential futures.
You go out, do your beeping.
See, I'll fly over the table right now.
My next guest can relate because as a teen, she was out of control and it led her to a life in a gang. It led her to prostitution. You devoted a lot of your life to rescuing young teens.
13 years ago, I bought an apartment building and I spent 10 years rescuing teen prostitutes from the streets because I used to be one. 4,500 kids later, I'm still rescuing.
But what got you to that point? What made you change?
The reality is that one day, my best friend died. She was the only friend that I had. And I was very suicidal, I was very sad, and one day I had to say to myself, you are responsible for the choices that you make, and you are responsible for your happiness, not your mother, not your father, not your grandparents, not your sister, not your brother. I am responsible for my happiness, and when I made that decision, my whole life changed.
Yes.
Because I used to be you and you, I know that things can change.
They headed straight to the Bergen County Jail.
My friend's daughter has been missing. We're going on a couple of weeks now. You think it won't happen to you or somebody that you know until it happens to you or somebody that you love. And then you're like, oh my God, please help me. That's where I come in. This is the work that I don't get on the internet and publicize because, you know, when it's somebody that you know and somebody that you love, you don't really want to exploit them. So now I'm at a motel. I'm at a motel so I can let them know in case she comes to check herself on in here that she shouldn't be here. Hi, sir. I don't mean to interrupt you. This is my friend's daughter. She was last seen here We don't know where she is, and I just wanted to know if you could keep this. I don't need you to post it, I just want you to keep it. In case somebody tries to bring her, she's underage. Yes. Hey there, brother. Do you live in this neighborhood? I'm gonna make it my mission, as I always do, to make sure that she's found. We think we found her at a liquor store. I'm on my way to the liquor store to go see if that's her. If it was your child, if it was your child, you would want somebody to do this.
So, I don't know if it's safe to leave you out here, because homegirl feels like you disrespected her hood, or the dude from her hood. But she says she's not going to put her hands on you or nothing like that.
She doesn't want to come with us. She needs to leave because she's already disrespected this young lady back here, her hood. And we don't want to leave her here at this point. We are.
I'm going to say it one more time before you get pissed off at me. I'm very happy to meet you.
So I actually had three friends who were killed right up the street. Drive-by shooting. And it's like, even when they catch the person that does such a thing, it never really brings solace to anybody because they're not here and they were innocent. And it's those types of deaths at like a very young age that I think it deepened my depression.
They said I'd never be a leader. They said I'd never wear a crown. If I wanted to be someone, I should learn to settle down.
You should know.
I tell myself.
So we are on Long Beach Boulevard, and this is actually where I used to come out to make money. So I was a high school student by day, honor roll, and by night, I was out here. The one thing that I can really remember about being out here is the embarrassment. I really didn't want anyone to see me that I went to school with because I lived this one life during the day, and at night I was somebody totally different. So I was always afraid. I didn't even really think about turning the trick and that being dangerous. I was just, every night I'd be like, oh my God, I hope that nobody I know comes down here. I hope that nobody I know lives over here, because it would be such an embarrassing thing for me. You know, because being a depressed teenager is really difficult, but being a depressed teenager who, you know, is suicidal and who is a self-mutilator, I mean, I literally, at any given moment of frustration, would just begin to slap my, just, and that pain is what a lot of these kids out here are feeling today. It's crazy, see that girl right there? I mean, she clearly shouldn't even be out here, not late like this and not dressed like that. You know, where are her parents? So I remember rescuing a girl named Brittany over at the McDonald's. She reminded me so much of, you know, a moment in my life where I actually saw my sister getting out of a car from turning the trick. And in the moment that I saw her, Brittany, over at the McDonald's, at the moment I saw her, I saw my sister, and I knew at that moment that I had to rescue her. And it became an addiction. It became an addiction to rescue these kids the same way that nobody rescued me, the same way nobody rescued my sister. I felt it was my duty because I understood them the most, and because they seemed to connect with me the most, I felt it was my duty to rescue them. And in the last 16 years, I've rescued over 5,400 kids with no fanfare, no cameras, no awards, no ego, just for the sake of rescuing.
Danny,
What?
I'm Justin's homeboy.
Pimps only scared of two things. They scared of losing their money and life in the penitentiary. Because you can't pimp in the penitentiary.
Danny?
Hi, this is Sharon. I'm Danny's mom. I was wondering, have you seen Danny or is she with you? I can't find her.
Who are you? Where's Justin?
Danny's missing. She was talking to this older man online and then they met up and now I can't find her anywhere.
The goddaughter that I've been banned from ever seeing again.
Sunshine here, she's gonna be a big money maker. You mark my words.
I filed the report. The officer told me to just keep my phone near me and wait.
It takes 48 hours to turn a girl out.
It's a girl. She's been snatched. She's only 15. But she's special to me.
She is a child. You let her go and give her a chance at a normal life.
The game is a game. And always will be.
The streets is dangerous. It ain't like it used to be, Peanut. Them boys bad news over there.
I'm bad news too.
I'll do what I have to do to get a girl out.